If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Motherfucker Pump.
Yeah.
For the first 40 minutes, we do our introductory conversation. We start off by talking about Thrive Market and how when you save money shopping on Thrive Market, they actually will let you donate some of your savings to help other people.
Save money and be a good person.
Feel good. Now, they are the largest online retailer of non-GMO organic food products. They also have skincare products, hairspray, deodorant, and other things that contribute to a healthy lifestyle. We are sponsored by them. If you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, we got you hooked up. You're going to get 1 month free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and free shipping. We also talked a little bit more about our Viore event and how we were serving beer, wine, and Brew Doctor kombucha.
Boom.
And to our delight and shock, the most popular drink there was the Brew Doctor kombucha.
Yeah, we had like none left. Everybody loved it.
Everybody was drinking that the most. Now, Brew Doctor, we're kind of working with them. They are 100% raw, organic, non-GMO, gluten-free, vegan. Of course, kombucha is a probiotic.
Best pooch
less
on the market.
Sugar than competitors.
That's right. You can find them at Whole Foods, Trader Joe's, New Seasons, Kroger, Sprouts. So if you drink kombucha, this is the one that we recommend. We talked about how I opted for Jersey Shore over Billions and Westworld. Keto Guido.
Shout out.
We talk about actions versus behaviors. Google Assistant. That was creepy. We talk about Cobra Kai.
Hi-ya!
Justin's learning some karate moves.
Oh, I love it.
New favorite show.
We talk about Seattle's new stupid head tax and how Amazon is going to stop making more jobs there if they don't change that. We talk about how Venezuelan money is worth less than World of Warcraft money.
That was great.
Sad statistic.
And how Apple profited more in the first quarter of this year than Amazon has in their entire existence.
They have so much cash.
Imagine getting your ass kicked that bad.
Ouch.
In profits. Pretty crazy. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, this person is feeling pain in their shoulder when doing overhead dumbbell extensions. Now, we talk about some correctional exercises he could do. We also mention Prime and Prime Pro, which you can find at mindpumpmedia.com. The next question was, in terms of getting lean, what's better, CrossFit or Orange Theory?
Or neither.
C, none of the above.
That's right. So we talk about which one we think is better in that part of this episode. And finally, the last question, how do we recommend people should measure their body fat? And what do we think is an ideal healthy body fat percentage for a woman who just wants to be fit, not a competitor? What's that body fat percentage look like? Also, this month, get the Intuitive Nutrition Guide and the Fasting Guide for absolutely free. Free. No money at all. $0.
Free.
If you enroll in any MAPS bundle. Now, bundles are where we combine two or more MAPS programs and discount them at a massive rate. For example, we have something called the Super Bundle, which is a year of exercise programming all planned out. In other words, you enroll in the Super Bundle, your entire year is set up for you. You know exactly what to do every single week, what exercises, reps, sets. There's videos of us demonstrating how to do the exercises correctly.
It's the blueprint to success.
Remember, all these programs were put together by super smart, experienced, and handsome personal trainers.
Definitely handsome.
I'm talking about us.
Yeah.
Again, enroll in any bundle. Get the Intuitive Guide and the Fasting Guide for free. You can find all of this at mindpumpmedia.com. Did you guys notice when you check out at Thrive Market that they let you donate a percentage of your savings? Because they'll show you at the end how much you've saved by shopping from, you know, with them or whatever.
Right.
Then you can donate some of that to charity.
Am I an asshole for saying that I didn't even know that?
Yeah. How fucking cool is that, though?
I didn't know that. How funny is it that we have badass...
Can we go back?
We have badass sponsors that we continue to learn things after. Yeah. Like, dude, did you know you could separate all the foods and shop this way?
They put their money where their mouth is. Like, they're really dedicated to helping, like, these causes and stuff like that. You know, they donate the membership. If every time you buy a membership, they'll donate one to a family that is, you know, low income, so they can have
organic food. Well, last night when we were in the jacuzzi and you were in, went to bed, we were talking with Taylor just about the brands that we're partnering with, and you know, we really want to move out of the traditional same old health and fitness brands that everyone's talking about. But Thrive and Organifi are really the exception to that rule. Mm. And Thrive, a lot of that is just they really are on brand for us. I mean, mm-hmm. they're aside from being health and fitness, but just the cause, the space, they're disrupting what they're doing.
Yeah, they're like humanitarians. They're like really considering like progress in society, not just like, you know, like a place for people to buy shit. It's
right.
Like, you know, let's do something good and impact the world. So, yeah, I love companies that are thinking that big.
Have you guys been able to turn on your family members to?
Oh, everybody. Yeah, yeah, no. Anybody that was a client of mine, anybody that's a family friend, like everybody. It's the reason why everyone uses it is because it's better.
The prices are hella
good. It's better yeah. for you, and the prices are competitive with.
You're kind of an asshole if you don't use them. You know?
If you don't at least try.
It's like, oh, I don't want to help people. I don't want to like save money.
So the most resistance that I get from anybody that hasn't tried it yet is just simply going through the process of first trying to, you know, it's like we get in this like rhythm of how we do things all the time. Like, oh, on Friday nights, I go grocery shopping at Safeway every single, you know, Friday night. Mm-hmm. And so disrupting that and like meaning, oh, I got to get on my phone or get on my computer to upload it or search on Thrive and then go from there. And then once you do it one
it's
time,
super easy.
Yeah, that's yeah. Once you do it one time, yeah. you realize how easy it is.
That yeah. 5 minutes it takes is a giant leap. You know
it
what
is.
I mean?
Yeah. It's a big barrier.
Isn't it crazy though how we are as humans yeah. though? That's true though. Like it's
well,
so.
We found that with the forum, you know, like just having people having to log in was like a huge barrier.
Oh, when we tried to go off
creatures of habit, yeah. you know.
Oh yeah, I tech. You know, people in the tech industry know that. They know that if they have to give you an extra step, even if it's just a click, mm-hmm. another link, they're gonna lose like 40% of their customers or engagement.
Crazy,
just it's from true, doing though. That. Yeah. But I mean, it's,
God, how we're lazy ass Americans.
So lazy.
I gotta push. I'm done.
I gotta go. You know what? Three screens.
No, what it is your expectations.
Yeah.
Like start to quickly change. There was yeah. a comedian that talked about
which
this.
Which I think is good and bad, right? I think it's cool. It pushes the market.
Well, it shows what's going on, right? Yeah. It shows what you know that our expectations are changing. But there was a comedian that did this bit about how being on a plane and how the Wi-Fi didn't work and how someone on the plane was like, this fucking piece of shit plane. And he's yeah. like, you're on a fucking tube flying through the sky at 600 miles an hour.
It's basically a magic cart in the sky.
Yeah. And I find myself like that too. Like when we were on the plane when we were coming here and my Wi-Fi started getting spotty and I was getting real irritated and I'm like, wait a minute. Like 4 or 5 years ago, it would have been a fucking miracle to have Wi-Fi in an airplane.
Oh, I know. Right.
And now I'm getting pissed off that, you know, it took me 5 extra seconds to log on.
I did get annoyed by
it's
that.
Silly.
I actually paid for it and mine didn't come through on this.
At all?
Yeah.
Well, that's,
Come did on. That happen to you guys?
Not the whole time.
This trip, it happened to me.
Were you trying to look at porn?
I didn't have my headphones.
No. Okay.
Not this trip.
I was going to say.
typically,
you were sitting next to an old lady. So
I was in the middle.
That's the best time.
Be careful.
I sat bitch on the way over here.
That's the best time. You ever feel, this actually happened to me the other day. You ever on your phone doing something and you know the person next to you
is watching.
Yeah, that happened with Justin actually.
Yeah.
We were waiting for dinner and I'm scrolling through Instagram or whatever, answering questions and shit, and I feel like, is this guy looking at me? So I stopped scrolling and I kind of just shook the screen a little bit, like neat, 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 back and forth. And he starts laughing. He goes, "You caught me, like,
caught me, bro. I was totally over your shoulder, dude. I needed entertainment. My phone's about to die. I was just like sitting there. I'm like, I'm gonna see what Sal's looking at.
That's hella funny.
It was kind of weird.
So I'll do that to my kids because my son will do that to me. Where I'll be like answering a question on the forum or something like that, and he'll be sitting next to me, and he's always, and I get mad at him because I'm like. You know, that's someone's privacy. Like, don't look over someone's shoulder. Don't look and see what they're doing on the phone.
Right.
But he constantly does it. So what I'll do now is if I'm sending a text and I feel like he's watching me, I'll change the text and say some shit to him.
Yeah.
So like, I'll answer
a
question.
You're watching.
Like one, yeah, like one of you guys, I'll be like, all right, so tomorrow we'll meet at 9 a.m. Domenico farted and he smells really bad.
He'll be like, hey, you got me.
He'll be like, oh, and he'll start laughing or some shit. Like that.
That's good.
You know what I'm trying to fix is because we were all business partners first and then have become, I think, closer friends, that when we go out socially, we still default to business mode. And so a couple times I've caught us like all right next to each other and we're all like on our phones in like a social environment where we're like at a restaurant or something like that. And I'm like, oh my God, this has to look so bad from somebody else. You got 5 guys all next to each other. Everybody's got their phone out looking down and it's like, oh my God, we're... Yeah. And I get it because we are working. So it's kind of, we're on a business trip. We've got all kinds of stuff to do. Like we're fucking. Yeah.
We're not dating. You know what I mean? Like I can answer some forum questions.
Adam, but really though, right? I know that's how we are all.
We're justifying
the perception of us.
Right, exactly. But the they don't know. They probably think we're five friends that are showing up to a restaurant to eat together.
Yeah. You know what it becomes obvious to me?
I'm like typing it in.
Yeah. You know what happened? You know what when it becomes obvious is when at the end Taylor will have a bunch of pictures from the trip. And I'll look at the pictures and like,
we're all like half of them,
someone's like, you know, just on their phone or all of us are on our phone. I'm like, oh shit, man. Yeah. That's why at dinner, there's a couple times where either I'll say it or even one of you guys will say it and be like, we'll take our phones and be like, all right, no phones.
Yeah.
Yeah. And let's just see what happens. It's actually better.
Yeah.
I feel like it's better.
It is better. I mean, giving us a little bit of a break though, like I said, we are, this is a business trip for us. I mean, since we've been here, there's stuff for us to be working on. I mean, I feel behind right now. There's things that we need to be getting done for when we get back on Monday and we got another event next week. And so, you know, nobody's on there. I don't feel like the five of us are sitting at the dinner table and people are fucking looking at booty shots on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Like everybody's in their emails.
Not anymore.
When we first started.
We really had to check each other on that one.
When we first started, there was
Sales in the weeds, you know.
You know, you guys joke like that, and then you guys get me in trouble. Because
come on, I'll throw myself under the bus.
Because then it sounds so much worse. God damn it.
You guys caught me a few times.
Dude, did I overhear Taylor correctly when I came downstairs? I guess when we did our event,
I tune him out most of the time.
That's me too. You know what I mean? That's why I want to be clear.
I have to deal with that guy.
It's
in one ear, out the other.
It's the sultry monotone voice that gets zoned out. But no, I was gonna say when I came down, I overheard him at the event. We were giving away free beer, free wine, and then free kombucha doctor.
Brew doctor.
Everybody
keep fucking this up.
Brew doctor.
You can't even do a commercial right today.
No. But listen, did I overhear him right? That was the most popular drink?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, dude.
It's really good.
It was so good.
So people were
that was my favorite.
People would rather drink that than the beer and the wine.
Yeah. Well, Shine Pump fans, what do you want?
Yeah.
You
know? That's true.
Yeah. Well,
if we were giving out weed, I'm sure they would have all taken that instead.
Yeah. Shout out to them, though, for, you know, sponsoring the event and hooking everybody up. I mean, everybody had unlimited drinks at this place, so you could be drinking beer, wine, or kombucha. Kombucha was the most popular drink, so shout out to them for supporting us and doing that. I know they're going to be supporting us out in Tahoe again, and I'm not sure about when we get up to Mir. I think we have something else going on at Mir, but for, you know, this company's been really cool, and I know Taylor's been talking back and forth with them, and they definitely see the value in podcasting. They love the brand and what we're doing.
We're talking about getting another tap, right, at the studio potentially with them. It would be amazing.
Brew Doctor's got to be the best. That's got to be the best one I think I've had so far.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, it's the effect it has on my gut. Here's the thing with kombucha. I don't know if you guys have noticed.
It has some of the lowest sugar in comparison, because some of these things are loaded full of sugar.
Part of it. And the other part is, I don't know if you guys have noticed this. You guys are not as sensitive as I am, but when I drink kombucha,
very true.
Although lately,
I'm glad you admitted that.
Although lately, we've been passing the microbiome around a little bit. I think that's what's happening.
Very true.
I don't know what you guys do in the middle of the night, so that's on you guys.
We do stuff to you.
It's
really good on my gut. Some kombuchas tend to bother me. Like some of them I'll drink and feel like they didn't really help or whatever. Brew Doctor has to be one of the better ones.
I keep forgetting
the name.
If we were at the studio, we'd have some.
You know what it is? Because you said Dr. Kombucha.
Which, I don't know. Is it? So you know why? Because Doctor is on the label. So I can see the label. Like, you know what I'm saying? I can see the label in my head. There's a doctor.
It reverts back to Dr. Pepper. Yeah. Like
yes. That's why Dr. Pepper, Dr. Kombucha.
Brew Doctor.
Brew Doctor.
Yeah, he's the Brew Doctor.
They're like, sorry, this is the last time we're going to do advertising with you guys since you can't get our name right and you tend to plug other kombuchas while you're talking about us.
Dude. Hey, so you guys don't watch Jersey Shore, huh? The reunion?
I only saw the first episode.
I saw the one where Snooki lost her ring or whatever. That was like the only one.
Wait a second, though. I do want to say something, though, because I it's in my like queue and I just haven't been around to it, because as far as like the list of priorities is, it's not the top five shows I want to get to. Have you not watched Westworld?
Or Billions?
And you're watching Jersey Shore. You deserve to get slapped for that.
I have a weird relationship with the Jersey Shore show. So when that show first came out,
I do a little bit too.
I watched it and I thought it was so. First off, it's terrible stereotypes of Italian people.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
So I'm kind of like, well, you know, because I grew up Italian.
Is it really terrible?
Yeah, well, yeah. You know what's, you
or
know,
they just being themselves.
Dude, stereotypes. Yeah. You know what I mean? No, I'm not saying that they're acting. That's yeah. who they are, but stereotypes a lot of times are based on some truth, right? They're just extreme versions of it.
Of course. No, you're
so
right.
As
they,
I'm watching, like,
they obviously casted these people with the intention of showing those extremes.
The
right?
one that, Vinny, for example, used to crack me up because his, like, when Vinny would have this overbearing mom who would, like, cut his meat for him.
Oh,
and, like,
yeah.
Do everything for him. And that's like a true thing in my culture, like, where the moms do everything for the son. But anyway, so I watched that all the seasons before, and my cousins would watch it, and we'd all laugh about it and joke and whatever. And then the show was over, and then the reunion came back, so it's just, you know, it's just like an old associate.
Nostalgia.
Relationship. So I'm watching it, and Paulie, so Vinny lost a bunch of weight and got, like, lean and shit, and I guess he eats a keto diet. So Paulie calls him the Keto Guido.
That's right.
The Keto Guido.
Every time you eat that way, I'm going to call you that now.
Bro.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I was dying of laughter. I can't believe nobody
throw
thought
Irish
of that.
Irish guy in there, McVegan. You know what I mean?
But you're not.
I know.
Yeah, you eat more.
That's the one thing that that's the one thing that they did good. I think that why that show did take off is all the funny nicknames and the funny sayings. I mean, the T-shirt time and the
cabs are here.
Yeah, I mean, they did so many little.
What's
one
the laundry? What's that like acronym they used to use?
Gym tan laundry.
That's what it is.
Yeah, gym tan laundry. The one that
DTF came from.
That's right. Everybody started saying that.
That was crazy.
Yeah, that did. The one thing that cracked me up the most that nobody ever really talked about was that. Do you guys ever watch the episode where I don't remember where they were? It happened during the World Cup, and during the World Cup, and I forgot where it was. There was everybody was blowing into those long, skinny plastic horns. Do you guys remember that? Mm-mm. At the World Cup, and it was like, and it became a thing. Like, and people were buying these horns. Well, on the Jersey Shore, I forgot which season it was. It might have been Miami, where they had one of these horns. And you know how they used to bring girls back to the place all the time?
Yeah.
And they would call, like, if there was, like, a group of four or five girls and there was one that was unattractive or whatever, they call it the grenade.
Yeah.
You guys remember that?
Yeah, the grenade.
So then there was one episode where they were bringing these girls, and I don't remember. I think it was Paulie was blowing on the World Cup horn.
Yeah.
And they called it the grenade whistle.
The grenade whistle.
Every time there was an unattractive girl. Yeah. Grenade whistle. They blow it.
Yeah.
I wish that caught on more. I thought that was so fucking hilarious.
Yeah. Nobody's going to be offended by that.
Dude.
It was so good. But anyway, so I got some articles here I want to bring. I've been saving these because they're a little controversial, but they're pretty cool.
We're staying on the controversial
here
train.
We go.
We dropped some episodes on God and then religion back to back.
Yeah.
And then we've been pushing politics. Like,
so
we just
decided to just.
No, this is a.
We're just daring our fans.
Well, no, this is a good one. This is a good one because many times things appear to be a particular way, but they're actually opposite. For example, I'll give you an example. There was that one study that I brought up a few times where I forgot what town it was or what city that made this ordinance that all restaurants had to list calories next to the you know options menu. On the menus, and they thought that this would help people lose weight and make better choices. And then when they did a study later on, they found that actually people chose to eat higher calorie options
right.
as a result, which sounds counterintuitive, but then they realize what happens is people look at two options and they say, oh, here's the healthier option, here's the less healthier option.
It's just like 100 more calories.
Yeah, or 300 more calories, and people don't really understand. They're like, oh, big deal. I'll just go with the one that I really want to eat or whatever.
Right.
So it's opposite, right?
It doesn't help when your treadmill say like triple what you're really doing too.
Let's talk about that for a second. How over bullshitted estimated are those fucking cardio machines?
Way off.
I remember clients used to get off those things and be like, yeah, I burned 800 calories on the treadmill.
Yeah, I did 30 minutes on the elliptical.
Yeah. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. You burned 800 calories on a treadmill.
Dude, what kind of elliptical are you doing for 30 minutes?
Uphill sprints.
But so a study done by Cornell and the University of Michigan found that there were people who were highly concerned about climate change. So these are people who are like, because they did surveys and stuff, and these are people who are like, okay, I am extremely concerned about climate change. This is a big deal to me. Were less likely to engage in recycling and other eco-friendly behaviors than global warming skeptics.
What?
Yes.
What?
Yeah.
How is that even possible?
I'm so concerned.
No. So at first it sounds like this doesn't make any sense. But when you think about it, it kind of does make a little bit of sense because the people who tend to be the more concerned crowd are the ones that advocate for...
They feel guilty.
No, they advocate for government regulation and government, you know, policies and changes. Like they want the government to make laws and stuff to fix this particular problem.
Versus trying to do something themselves.
That's right. That's right.
That's funny.
Versus the global warming skeptics, who also generally tend to be the more, the individuals who are more pro individual action. Like, you know, like I need to, I got to do my own changes. I'm not worried about everybody. I don't need to force everybody else to do things. I'm going to do things for myself. Those are the people that tend to do the things that tend to be better for the environment, according to this particular study. Mm. Now, this echoes similar studies that have been done on people who on charity. So they've done studies and they found that people who advocate for the most government programs to help the poor also tend to donate the least amount of money to charities, and people who don't tend to donate the most. And they control that for income too. So some people say, well, some people have less money. No, when they control for income, people who are less like pro-government force or government providing these things tend to do things more on their own.
Yeah, they want dad to do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think that kind of that tends to be true, right? Like if you feel like everybody else is doing something, you tend to do less of it yourself. But if you feel like nobody's going to do it,
yeah, you gotta get your hands dirty.
Get my hands dirty a little bit. How crazy is that?
That's interesting, though.
It is interesting.
Yeah, it's kind of like human behavior is interesting in that particular respect.
Right. I feel like it's like a guilt thing. I think by
I do too.
Just saying it or saying that it's important or like making a point to fight for the cause makes you feel better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that's the only thing that you're really feeling. Like do you care that much about the cause, or you just care about acting like you care about the cause?
It's true. Right? It's true. Because if you look at someone's behaviors.
Getting social cred for it.
You know? Yeah. Like if you look at someone's behaviors and their actions, you can tell pretty quickly if they really do care about something.
Right.
You know, if somebody really, really cares, then they'll change their own behaviors rather than just talking about
actions.
Yeah. And it's also more empowering when people start to do that, but it's also more responsibility. Like I could complain all day long about climate change and about how I think it's important that we protect the environment. But then if I go and change my own lifestyle, well, that requires a little bit of work on my part. And I think a lot of people are much more willing to speak out and far less willing to do
I feel the same way about like trying to help people get in shape. And like we had a question
totally asked, 100% right,
asked about, like, you know, what do I do about my parents and trying to get them in shape, and or I have a spouse or this person who I want to get in shape. And it's like, you know, honestly, you could sit there all day long and spin your wheels on all the things that you can do to make their life easier so they get in shape, or by educating them to get them shape, or you can be that change in their life by doing it within yourself, mm-hmm. right? And letting them see that. And I think that's way more powerful. I remember when I first came into Katrina's family. I mean, they probably for a year or two there, you know, they gave me a lot of shit, man. They gave me a lot of shit for
being weight.
Well, yeah, because I'd bring my food to fucking family events. You know, yeah. You're the new boyfriend in town and shit like that. Like, what an asshole, you know? But I did my best.
Like my pie.
I did my best not to be like that. You know, like to kind of explain why and stuff like that, and be like, no. I mean, it doesn't bother me. Everyone drink, do your thing, stuff like that. I just right now I have, you know, personal goals that I'm trying to achieve, and it's important that I eat this way, and so. But I think over time, the entire family watched me transform my body, watched the way Katrina and I live our life. Now the whole family is like always trying to learn more. Every time we're around food on there, they're asking questions now. They're like, hey, would this be a better choice, or should we do this? Or, you know, can we make this dish, and is that healthy? Or I heard this, and like I never had to say, you know, oh, you shouldn't do this, or oh my God, you're going down this wrong path, and you're going to be overweight, and you're going to get all these diseases, and it's going to be this. Like, yeah. I don't have to scare anybody or make anybody feel a certain way. Just I focused on myself.
It requires a strong character to be able to do that, because you're going to get hit from so many different angles and from so many different people, and you're going to be the one that stands out, and you're going to be the one that's weird at the party or the whatever. So it requires that somebody kind of is very solid and strong and confident within themselves. And no, I think you're absolutely right. I think constantly preaching to people versus being the example and just worrying about yourself, there's a big difference in effectiveness.
Yeah, because the real people that are going to make the change are going to see that, because they have to first want to, right? You cannot force your parents or anybody else to want to get in shape.
It has to be their own idea.
Right. And there's no better way, in my opinion, to be that visual example for them to want to ask you that. Mm-hmm. You know, most people will, like, if they see, and most people I feel like are battling inside of like, do I want to make the effort to do this or should I? And they're watching you. If you're the person that's healthy, that or the healthiest person they know in their life, they're looking to see you fail. They're looking to see you not follow through, eat terrible, do these things, say you're healthy for about a 6 month period, and then you fall off, and you're this, and they're like, "Oh, good. He's just like me."
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's I'm glad I didn't listen to his bullshit when he was trying to preach to me 6 months ago. You failed too. You're just like me.
It makes you feel better about yourself when you know if you have a friend and you know they are working really hard, and you're like, "Come on, man, just relax." Like, who cares? Enjoy yourself. And your friend's like, no, I'm really focused on this particular goal. It makes you feel better to see that they fall off, because then you feel better about yourself. If they succeed, all of a sudden, now you have to ask yourself the question like, well, shit. Well, yeah, maybe I was.
Should
the,
I be doing this?
Yeah, yeah, maybe I was the one that should have done that. And you put it on them without really, you know, you're not pounding them with it. You're just that example.
Yeah, you're just modeling it.
I used to get clients that would tell me, that would come bring their kids with them to the gym, and they'd be like, Sal, can you tell my son why it's so bad to eat chicken nuggets and drink soda and whatever? Like, can you talk? And there's like a 10-year-old kid. And then I would go to the parent and be like, just don't have it. Like, don't do it in the house. Like, you don't like, what do you mean? I'm not going to convince your kid.
Right.
Yeah. They live with you. They're watching what you do, obviously.
Right.
It's like being a smoker and trying to tell your kid that smoking is bad. Don't smoke. Meanwhile, you're the one that's doing it.
Right.
You know, it's that whole example thing. So. Yeah, definitely requires a certain level of responsibility, and it's that individual action. I mean, again, this all sounds you know silly, but if everybody just focused on themselves and did what was best for themselves, then you'd see the massive change that people.
Yeah. Did you see? I don't know if Justin saw it. I saw you sent over on the thread yesterday the Google, was it not Google? Who was it that? What company is it that is doing the AI.
Oh, yeah.
To answer the calls and set you up.
Bro, did you guys
Google,
watch that?
Wasn't it?
Is it Google?
I think it is.
Okay, did you watch that?
I thought it was Google, yeah.
I didn't watch it. I was reading like
bro,
what was going so on with
it's
it.
It's cool. Google Assistant.
Yeah. It's okay. Cool. It's very cool.
So it's Google Assistant.
People are freaking out.
Because of how real
how
it
real,
sounds.
Yeah.
So what you'll do is you'll tell your Google Assistant, hey, book me dinner at 9 p.m. at, you know, whatever restaurant. Google Assistant will call the restaurant, and then they played the actual conversations between the people.
Yeah, with a live person who's answering
a live person and Google Assistant. And you can't fucking tell.
Can't distinguish it?
You can't tell who's not real.
I mean, it wasn't even a straightforward conversation. It was like, oh, sorry, that time is not available. And then the fucking Google Assistant replies, oh, well, how about these times?
Westworld's happening, bro.
Dude, it was creepy.
Yeah, it's cool.
Weird.
It's cool, though.
Weird, right?
That's really cool, I think.
It is. Yeah. It is, but it's also kind of strange.
I mean, just imagine how much you could... I mean, I think for me, a guy like me, that really, really would help out to have this virtual assistant that I could just... Every time I think about it, I put it in my calendar real quick, like, make sure this happens. Make sure this happens. And it's just, all I have to do is put the note in or whatever for them to know to... call and set. And
don't worry, Adam. I got you covered.
Oh, dude. it even picks up like the mannerisms, dude, or the lingo, like the way that
the pauses and the and
yes,
the,
it's trippy.
I have two new books for you in your library.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it talks like this, like we're talking,
oh, like just normal.
You can't fucking tell, dude. Right. It's so weird.
Yeah, it's really cool.
You'd be like, Google Assistant, can you call my girlfriend and apologize? You know,
I saw Justin. You were watching.
Sure she's
were watching this morning. The Karate Kid on YouTube,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Oh, Cobra Kai.
Oh, you watched it?
Yeah, bro. The
You're
first
an asshole.
Episode. Yeah.
You know, I don't have Google Red.
Oh, it's a
Red.
Season.
Yeah. Yeah, there's
that's
episodes.
Why I sent it to you guys.
It's so good.
It's produced by Google Red just on YouTube Red. YouTube Red. Mm-hmm. It's only on YouTube Red, and it's a whole series, and it follows up on
Johnny on, and
now is it their
Danny
kid?
LaRusso. No, well,
it's them
they
older.
haven't really got to the I just watched the first episode.
I think Danny's an asshole now.
Yeah, he owns like car dealerships, and he's just like, he's a little bit of an asshole. And like, they kind of take it from Johnny's perspective of like being down and out, you know, and like he keeps reflecting on getting kicked in the face. And, oh my God, it's so funny. It's like, it's such that like old dry humor. And he's watching like Iron Eagle, you know, and so they add all this like old 80s feel to
so
it.
So it's actually good, huh?
It's good, man. Like, it's good writing. I was like, I thought it might be like super cheesy and terrible, but like it's like cheesy, but like
dude,
good. It's like nostalgic cheesy.
All these platforms are getting their
producing own stuff.
Yeah. I fucking love it, dude.
Is YouTube Red worth it?
I'm not paying for it. This is free. So
how did you? What is it? A trial?
Yeah.
Oh shit! I'm gonna do that just to watch Karate Kid.
Yeah, I think that they're letting it, you know, go as free for a while, so people kind of like get introduced to it.
Karate Kid has to be easily one of the most impactful movies of my youth.
Oh, really?
Yeah, man. Easily.
No,
yeah.
Me too, man. That easily. Was a staple. Like, yeah, like, because you remember that. You remember how uncomfortable you were, like, trying to kind of prove yourself, like, you know, like the whole bully thing, like, getting through that process, like, when you're a kid. Like, I just remember, because, like, Johnny was such, like, the stereotypical, archetype of a bully guy, you know. But then you watch it now, like, as you're older, like, the old movie, and you're, like, totally rooting more for Johnny. Like, you're like, dude, Danny's such a little bitch. You know, like, the whole time he's crying about, he could have let it go, right? But no, he goes and fucks with him again, you know, pours water on him.
Yeah, that part.
Like, come on, dude.
Yeah.
Like, you're just stirring the bees.
Yeah.
They were just trying to smoke a joint in the bathroom.
Yeah, man. He's just trying to have a little party. Yeah. You're gonna dump water on him?
No.
Well, you deserve to get your ass kicked,
and
sir.
It didn't help for me that people kept telling me when I was a kid that I looked like him.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. So, of course, I was like,
Your son looks like him.
Yeah.
Like, I look at your boy and I go, oh, my God, he looks just like Danny Rousseau for sure.
My friend got that a lot, too. My best friend growing up, because he, you know, he's Italian. He looked just like him, too. So, he would get that all the time. Like, girls were like, oh, you look just like Danny.
Yeah. I didn't like his girlfriend. I never liked his girlfriend.
Are you serious?
No.
Oh, she's a babe.
No, she was, but she was like too, like, bigger than him almost. When you see him together, you're like, oh, that's right.
Yeah, but yes, it does.
He was a skinny little twerp.
When I was that old, all the girls were bigger than you. Sixth, seventh, and eighth grade, the chicks were bigger, dude. Yeah.
What grade is he in that movie?
She was like, what grade was he in? He was in high school, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think he was in high school.
Well,
yeah.
Just
was he a freshman or sophomore?
Yeah, just like a freshman.
But that's what, I mean, really, that's what, I mean, my, from sixth grade to probably sophomore year, most of the girls were our size or bigger. You know,
developed before us.
Yeah, most boys don't sprout up till about their sophomore, junior year in high school. And
what a brilliantly written movie, too. It stood the test of time. I mean, watching him do all those chores, and then, you know, Mr. Miyagi's like, actually, you've been learning karate this entire time.
Yeah, like
he Huckleberry Finned his ass, you know what I mean? He like tricked him real quick. You know what I'm saying? What a brilliant movie. But yeah, definitely one of my favorite movies of my youth. So I'm excited to watch it. I'm going to say
you'll love it,
free
dude.
Trial.
Yeah,
for
you'll
sure.
Love it.
Dude, did you see? So, because I know we're heading up to Seattle coming up here soon, right? We're going to be doing. Is that where which one's in Seattle?
Mir.
That's Mir.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know Amazon's headquarters up there?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. So Seattle
and Microsoft.
Seattle has to be one of the worst cities for economic policies. It's terrible. It's like the Seattle, San Francisco, like all these cities that just are basically trying to destroy themselves with their idiotic economic policies. And so what Seattle's doing, because Amazon is in the middle of building or expanding their headquarters to add, like, I don't know how many tens of thousands of employees. And Amazon brings the city of Seattle, I don't know how many millions of dollars in tax revenue already and jobs, right? So Seattle passed a I think it's called a head tax. So if you're a company that generates over $20 million in revenue, not in profits, by the way, so there's a problem there already. Mm. If you generate over $20 million in revenue, they're going to charge you, and if I'm not mistaken, the amount is something like $40-something dollars a head for people who work there.
What?
Yeah. So they're about to dramatically increase the amount of taxes.
Well,
it's called a head tax.
Yeah, but I don't understand the theory behind that. Just to collect more taxes, and so
pay for housing for homeless people is what they'll say, right? That's what they're saying. They're saying we need more housing for homeless people. This is how we're going to generate the revenue. We're going to charge a head tax on these companies. So Amazon, and this is what happens. What do you think is going to happen, right?
We'll go put our base somewhere else.
Yeah. So Amazon.
Why would you stay there?
Amazon halted their construction. They're like, we're not going to keep building. And now they're trying to negotiate with the city. And so then the city's trying to paint Amazon as this evil corporation that doesn't want to help homeless people. Except, it wasn't that long ago that Amazon actually donated a shit ton of money and actually, I think, built a massive housing facility on their dime for homeless people. How fucking stupid.
That is beyond stupid. Good for fucking Bezos, though, for fucking fuck you. You know what I'm saying? That probably lost him money even to do that.
You start
contracts like that, and I'm sure that they probably already started spending money in that direction.
Yeah.
But I would do the same fucking gangster move, too. Like, fuck you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like we put,
that doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't make any sense whatsoever, because imagine how much that's going, how positive a big, huge company like Amazon coming into
it. Oh, my God. Area.
I mean,
tremendously.
I remember when Tesla just came up to Reno, where my sister lives.
Yeah, why'd they do that? Because California was being a bunch of dumbasses.
And so they go up to Reno, and now you see the whole town. I mean, it brings like 3,000 or 6,000 jobs right away to a town.
This economy's changed. Yeah, right, yeah, no dude. Shit.
It's so silly.
It's ridiculous. It's such a stupid mentality. One thing I think people need to understand is if you're not lying, cheating, stealing, you don't have that cronyism where you're partnering up with politicians to create barriers so other people can't compete with you, whatever. Definitely not the case with Amazon. Definitely not the case. Amazon is a tech company. It's very, very free. They dominate because they're so good, not because they've been given special treatment or because there's all these barriers that they that they've enacted or put up for their competition, through laws or legislation. One thing you understand is when a company or an individual becomes extremely successful in a market economy, when a company generates billions of dollars, that alone is doing a massive service to society.
Right.
Okay? If you I'm going to trip people out by saying this, and I'll back it up. If you live in a market economy and you're an honest person, one of the best things you could do is get rich as fuck. Literally. Because in order for you to get rich as fuck, that means you have to serve a whole bunch of other people's interests.
Right.
You have to create something that a lot of people want, or do something a lot of people want, or give people a service that people find valuable, more valuable than their dollars.
Right.
So that means you're already doing a massive, massive service. Right. So like, for example, if you look at Amazon, you think, oh, evil corporation. What do you think would happen if we erased Amazon from existence, if they had never existed at all? How much less money would people have in their pockets for savings?
Right.
Think of the ways that they've...
Less jobs, everything.
Think of how they revolutionized shipping. Think of how they revolutionized, how they've allowed small businesses to build online presence, online business. Right. Without Amazon, it was much more difficult to create an online business. You had to, ship your own products. You had to store them, whatever. Now with Amazon, and sure, they take a big chunk out of it, but boy, have they made it a lot easier for companies to exist online. And so I think it's insane that we tend to do this with legislation and laws. We tend to fuck these or just shoot ourselves in the foot. It's so stupid.
It is.
Yeah. What are they going to do now, right? If Amazon said, fuck you, what are they going to do now? You know what the chain of events that happens in some of these societies is then, and it won't happen here, thankfully, but it's happened in other countries, is first they'll say, you got to pay us this massive tax. Then the company says, we're going to leave. And then they'll say, we're going to make it illegal for you to leave. And the company say, well, we'll shut down. And then they'll say, well, we're going to take all your assets then. And they'll play this fucking game. And you see this in socialist societies that start to spiral downward, like Venezuela, where, now Venezuela, I don't know if you guys saw this, but Venezuela money now is worth less than World of Warcraft money.
Oh, no.
Is that a true stat?
It's true.
It's like...
You can sell your World of
Warcraft. I feel bad laughing because the poor people that are there, but like, oh my God, that is a fucking funny stat.
You can sell your World of Warcraft money for more.
Oh my God, dude.
I know. Wow. That's sad.
That's sad.
I feel bad for laughing, but
That's
a great
that's
stat.
Crazy. That's crazy. That's crazy.
So speaking of laughing, right, on the same topic, Amazon, fucking behemoth of a company, crushing and destroying everybody, right? And everybody's like, oh, Amazon rules the world. Here's a stat that's going to fucking trip you out. That's probably going to piss off Bezos. Apple made more profit in 3 months than Amazon has generated during its entire lifetime.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Apple generated a $48.3 billion profit during its fiscal 2017 and made $13.8 billion in net income during the March 2018 quarter.
Still off their iPhones,
while
right?
Amazon's total net income since inception is $9.6 billion.
Yeah, but that's
how much money Amazon makes.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Do you know Amazon has more cash than the government?
You're talking about Apple. Amazon or
Apple? Apple.
Yeah, it's all Apple. Well, that's the thing. They're just pure liquid cash, man.
Yeah, that's the difference, though. So you have a luxury brand like Apple versus a tech brand or gig, right, during this whole gig explosion with Amazon. And so Amazon is like the long play, right? That's like when you look at, and that's why the book,
taking over other industries.
The Book of Four is a really cool read around this, because Amazon is not just crushing right now, which they are, but and you compare them to Apple as far as profits, Apple looks bigger and better financially, like year over year, but they're also Amazon's spending
who owns the cloud.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's talk about that.
They're spending a lot of money to own a lot of real estate and have a lot of control of markets that at any point they're, I mean, that's the way I look at it. They're looking more about power than they are dollar right now.
Which will turn into money.
Right.
Yeah. But now explain this to me, because I've heard you guys say this before and I kind of understand it, but I've heard you guys say that Amazon owns the cloud. So what do you mean by that? They own all
the servers. So the cloud still has to, I mean, you still have to have servers, right? It has to go somewhere. And so they own like the majority of like all these servers somewhere. I don't know if it's in Arizona or like some desert where
Google and whatever uses.
They pay for the storage basically in a sense to go through that. So like when you're downloading things from the cloud, like it's actually going through. You know, they're providing that service.
So in other words, as other tech companies grow and require more and more of this,
and you
Amazon
just can't, they're so big at this point that you can't compete with it. Like you can't. It's like think of like somebody trying to come up and like compete with like cell phone towers, right? Like trying to come in and compete with the guys that have the market. They have everything. They already have a monopoly on it. They have a monopoly on
Comcast.
The cloud.
Yeah, they got all the everybody's jacked in with Comcast already. Like good luck. Like we're trying. I really want somebody to compete though.
Comcast is different because Comcast, the only reason why they've achieved that level of domination is because there's laws that make it so hard for anybody else to try to compete. But Amazon, that's a different story. Although I will say this, the thing about technology that's pretty fucking exciting, it only takes one dramatic, massive shift or change in tech and the way we store things for that to be obsolete. Like if all of a sudden there's a server, let's say a quantum server, you know, gets created where you have a server the size of my phone now that can contain as much information as a building full of servers.
Well, that's just
Amazon
it.
Becomes obsolete.
Well, that's just it. Amazon is leading the way in that.
Mm-hmm. They're constantly spending.
There's other companies that are trying to come on and like have their own private cloud. And even for themselves to host that, to run that, to manage that costs more money than it would cost them to just get with Amazon.
Right.
So it's like unless you're getting in the business of the cloud, which most people aren't, they just want to use the cloud. It doesn't even make sense to even try and compete with Amazon because it's the same way with shipping with Amazon. They flip the funnel on its head.
They'll eat at the profit.
The same way they flip the funnel on its head with buying things online.
Now explain that for a second because people listening need to understand that part because that was them doing that just totally disrupted the entire internet.
Well, yeah, they've become the go-to. Like you see all these companies, anybody who ships online uses Amazon because they've made it so user-friendly for both the consumer
and the producer.
And the producer. It's like a no-brainer. Everything from, like you said before, the shipping, they make it so easy and they make it so fast that nobody can compete with it.
Yeah, that's
and
a
even
big
if,
one.
Even if another brand tried to come in to try, it's too late. It's too
and
late.
They can house it in their warehouses and everything, inventory.
Do you know how long the U.S. Post Office said it was impossible to do overnight shipping and to ship things that quickly? They would say that it was impossible. They said it for decades. Impossible, impossible, impossible. Then UPS, FedEx, and Amazon came out, private companies, and showed like this is how it
Well, I don't know. I don't know the numbers on this, but I do know that part of the reason why they could do that is again, why they're not the most profitable right now is they take a lot of big losses to win the market share.
Sure.
You know, so even when they first did that, I'm sure, and I know I've read it somewhere. I just don't remember the numbers. Like, you know, when they first started all that stuff, they weren't making a ton of money. You know, they were probably losing, in fact, when they were shipping for such a low price. They're probably having to pay employees and storage and all these
things. It's the model, man. Because
it's just like
didn't they just raise the price of Prime?
Yeah.
Amazon? Didn't Amazon Prime go up in cost? And nobody's going to fucking
stand like
for
it. It's just like what they're doing with AI right now. I mean, they're losing money every single month on the amount of money they're spending on AI. You know, and building these factories that will just be automated. They're not making money off that. Nobody's paying for that. They're paying out of their own pocket to create that. But once it's operational and running, it's game over.
Well, that's why, I mean, Apple, they're going to hit the $1 trillion cash mark first.
Apple?
Yeah, I can almost guarantee it.
Oh, dude.
Because that's their only objective is that. Like, it just seems like they're trying so hard to just get as much cash and squeeze as much out of consumers as possible.
That, it's either that or we see like Apple get almost there and then Amazon turn the switch on so many markets. Like they're trying to move into the space of, I mean, they're getting into like the shipping containers and over, I mean, they're-
the drone deliveries?
Yeah, they're fucking with huge markets right now that-
Shipping container one?
Yeah.
Like that is a huge market and it's so wrapped up in red tape and all this bullshit. It's such an antiquated way of handling things because there's all these protectionist laws.
Between that, between education, between the shit. I mean, they're getting their hands on all these markets that regardless if they're making a lot of profits right now, but they're proving that it can be done more efficiently. Once they prove that and everybody's on board to where it's like a no-brainer, like why would I not have Amazon? Because it includes all these things. Yeah. I get Prime shipping, all this.
And that's just it. Like think about it this way. When you want, you know, drastic and dramatic changes or innovations, it requires a lot of capital and risk, right? When you're looking at a system that's been around for a long time and you're looking at it and you're, let's say you're a company and you're like, okay, we want to make this system that's been around for 50 years or 30 years, we want to make it far more efficient. How do we do that? Because it's been done this way for so long. We need to spend a lot of money and time figuring that out. We need to invest a shit ton of capital. Well, if you're throwing a fucking head tax on Amazon's headquarters because you're Seattle and you think you're, you know, whatever, you're taking away money that they would invest in these risky type
growth,
of things.
In growth.
Yeah. Right. And it's their money to do so, here's why I don't like government investing in that kind of stuff. Like you're taking my money and you're fucking risking it. Amazon, that's their own goddamn money.
Right.
They're going to take it and risk it. And if they succeed, they do. And if they fail, they lose their money.
Right.
When government does it and they fail, they lost my money.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So right.
Nobody wins.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. So like, let them have that money so that they can figure out and reinvest. People don't realize just how much money goes back into reinvesting a business when you're profiting. I mean, look at our company, our business, you know, Mind Pump. As we grow, people, you know, might look and be like, oh, they must be paying themselves more and more money. No.
No.
No. It hardly changes how much we pay ourselves because there's so much more reinvestment into trying to grow and, you know, add more people and become more efficient. So, but crazy, dude, 2017, $48 billion in profit they made. That is an insane amount. If that's Apple, insane amount of cash.
The race to a trillion, man.
Yeah, man.
That is an insane amount. It's kind of exciting, if you ask me.
Yep. Bring on the bird, Douglas.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
Our first question is from Mitch W. Basketball 15. Why am I feeling pain whilst doing overhead dumbbell tricep extensions where the deltoid originates from the acromion
process?
Process, yeah.
I love when people give a detailed question like that.
Yeah.
So I think we should explain what that person's doing and where they feel pain right now. So they're doing an overhead extension, right, where you have a dumbbell behind it. Really common, someone will sit like at a 90-degree bench where you're sitting up, right, in like a chair.
Mm-hmm.
And then they grab a dumbbell and they cup it behind their head and they do overhead extension. So, and that requires really good shoulder mobility to bring the dumbbell back behind your head. And this is very common, actually. It's really common that people struggle with. In fact, I've seen a lot of people injure themselves going really heavy on tricep extensions behind their head. And it's not because of their triceps or they don't have enough strength. It's because they don't have the shoulder mobility.
Well, they're just not raising their arm and pulling it back in that position like ever.
Right. They've lost connection there.
Now, this area is where the scapula, the top of the shoulder blade attaches to the top of the shoulder blade attaches to the collarbone.
Mm-hmm.
So it's called the it's the acromioclavicular joint is where he's feeling this pain,
right.
And this is a common area that people will get.
Just like the top front of your shoulder.
Yeah. So like
if you're the AC joint.
Yeah. So if you're touching your collarbone and you move it all the way out towards your shoulder, it's like the end of that particular.
That's where I'm like really bony. Kids used to make fun of me right there.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you cry?
I did.
But that's a common area to separate. In fact, getting a partial separation there or getting like osteoarthritis or inflammation there is common. They call it bench press shoulder.
Well, you know, I can't remember where I read this, but it only takes 40% of your intensity to pull the shoulder out of its socket. Like, so you
40% of your strength.
Yeah. So like you, if so you could, yeah. So you don't even have to be lifting like a max load, but if it's out of position, and I may not be wording that correctly or saying it right, but the point of it was that it doesn't take very much mm-hmm. weight or stress for you to dislocate your shoulder or injure it when it's out of position. It's because it's a multifaceted mm-hmm. joint, like the hips. It's a very, it's really easy for us to get hurt yeah. if you do not have the right mobility. Yeah,
you see this, it's a problem. You see heavy benchers with yes. where their technique is off. You see this problem a lot in that particular part of the shoulder. Because it stabilizes the shoulder joint in that horizontal, you know, plane where you're laying on your back. It's actually a little easier on that area when you do an incline, believe it or not.
This is the real magic behind MAPS Prime Pro, was that we take every major joint in the body and we address it and we make sure that it has the ability to take that joint through full range of motion. And most people for sure are going to find several of the joints in their body are not able, they cannot do this.
Yeah. And well, they need to just the rotators, like having internal, external rotation and
right. How know, many people can actually,
how many can, yeah. How many people even practice that? And that being such a crucial part to this whole process of being able to stabilize. So it doesn't move off track.
Right.
So the biggest thing is like you start to get, you know, your bone gets like a little bit off track. Now where it starts getting closer and closer to where it becomes that impingement. So mm-hmm. that's where we get that pain yeah. sensation starts to form.
This tends to be a dysfunction in the scapula and the shoulder joint, the shoulder blade. So in Prime Pro, we have movements that you can work on for specifically for the shoulder blade, which is part of the whole shoulder structure. Because a lot of times we focus on just the shoulder itself, or at least the upper arm part of the shoulder, the humerus. But that scapula, your shoulder blade, it plays a massive role mm-hmm. in the function of your shoulder joint. And in this particular issue probably has more to do with this shoulder blade than it does...
Right, proper retraction and depression.
That's it. So that, and that's probably what your problem is. I would say, okay, obviously, number one, avoid that exercise for now, but then focus on bringing the shoulder blades back and down and right. doing exercises that help stabilize that back and down position. Because what's happening, what might be happening is your shoulder blade is elevating or shrugging and rolling forward a little bit or turning out a little bit or maybe even winging a little bit, which will cause problems in that AC joint as you bring your arm, you know, over your head. So if you prime properly, you may be able to get in that position without having pain. So one thing that I can recommend that might be is easier to explain over a podcast would be to do some really light rows where
we created the MAPS Red Row from this. That's for to teach you to retract like that in like in a seated row position, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. retract and then depress the shoulders.
Yeah, so I would say do a light row, pull the shoulder blades back and then down. So it's like you're trying to get your shoulder blades and put them in your back pockets. Mm-hmm. Focus on that squeeze, hold that squeeze for 3 seconds, do a few repetitions like that, and then go and do your overhead exercise and place that shoulder in that position and then see if you still feel pain.
So since we started Mind Pump and this whole fucking phone thing and us sitting down
yeah.
and rounding and I can see my posture rounding forward, it has become now mandatory that before I do bench press, I have to do rows. I have to do that.
Oh, really? Because it bothers you more now?
Even, yeah. Or else I'll feel that like kind of impingement in my shoulder.
Oh,
and
wow.
I know right away that it's just, and once I go do 2 or 3 sets of some really good rows where I'm concentrated on retracting, depressing, then I go right back into chest, instantly alleviates.
Yeah, I'll do like what we have in Prime Pro. We have these shoulder scap kind of circles where you take it through.
Oh, that's the best.
Oh, man. Yeah. It's so great for priming and getting into proper position, you know, when I go to bench, because that was a big problem for me, is I would feel that impingement start mm-hmm. to form just because I would get to a certain sticking point where the load would put enough pressure to where I was like, oh shit, okay, mm-hmm. you know, I'm not stabilizing properly.
It's also a common area of injury for football players mm-hmm. because of the when they
Impact.
Tackle. Yeah, you mm-hmm. tackle with your shoulder and you get a lot of these AC joint separations. Mm-hmm. I had my AC joint, my left side, I had it resected. I had about maybe 3 millimeters resected off the end of it because I had separated it, just a partial separation in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And then the doctor said, okay, well, you can stop Jiu-Jitsu for 6 months and let yourself heal, or I can give you a cortisone shot so you can keep doing Jiu-Jitsu. and then we'll see what happens. And so I chose the stupid option and ended up making it much worse. And then I had to get shoulder surgery. Now my right one bothers me a little bit.
Can you talk about that? Like how, what a bad decision getting those shots are?
Oh, man. I mean, I understand if there's like really bad acute inflammation, get rid of the pain to maybe.
I hate even saying that. Though,
well, no, because not because
everybody who has it and has pain and it gets the shot, it's like, oh, if you only knew it's in so much pain, like you don't
want to. No, it's not because I didn't want the pain. I'm not saying this because you should get rid of the pain, although I am empathetic to that as well. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is sometimes you need to get rid of inflammation so that you can do the movements that will help that area. But most people don't use them that way. Most people get the shot and they're like, I'm better.
No,
and then they go do whatever they were doing.
Like normal things.
Like everybody.
Everybody.
Like I don't know a client one that I had that gets the shots for the pain and that would come to me and be like, yeah, I got the shot. It brought the inflammation down. Now I'm doing my mobility work. I'm doing the exercises to fix this. They're like, oh, I feel great.
No, I feel normal.
And they go right back to doing everything that they've been doing, and which got them in that situation. They don't even realize it. Yep. And then next thing you know, 2 months down the road, they're in pain again, and they're getting the shot again. And it's just this vicious circle.
Those shots, if you keep using them, will deteriorate your fucking joint in a very, very bad way because inflammation
A shitty Band-Aid. They're not even a good Band-Aid. Yeah.
Inflammation is a signal for your body to repair and to heal. And when you zap it out of there with a cortisone shot, that joint can start to deteriorate. So you start to see people getting these every single year, and every year things start to get worse, and then they have to get a joint replacement. That's always the follow-up.
Right.
So if you do get one of those shots, use it as a way to help you rehab, not as a way to like, oh, it's gone. I feel fine now, and I've never had, pain. You know, my pain's gone now, so everything must be better. Here's something that, Dr. Brink taught us a while ago that I thought was absolutely brilliant. He says, when you work on an area and you start to correct, imbalances or work on recruitment patterns and the pain goes away, that doesn't mean that you're done.
Right.
Because pain is like the last signal. Right. That's when you're like, oh, you're fucked.
That's when it's screaming at you.
That's right. It's like you got to keep working past that. Because pain is a terrible signal. If you just rely on pain, you're going to be in a bad situation. Like, oh, I stop until I start to hurt myself. And then I feel a little better and I go back and forth.
This is also why all of our Prime and Prime Pro tests that we have in there are either pass or fail.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not like, this isn't a matter of
a scale.
Yeah, just because you don't have pain in that area doesn't mean there's not work to be done for that joint. So it's like, okay, if you can't do the movement 100% perfectly, then there's work to be done there. And how bad it is how much work you need to be putting into that
joint.
Dude,
just think of it this way. If you're listening right now, think of it this way. Imagine if you were able to just get into any exercise and feel comfortable, and the limiting factor just simply be that maybe your strength, but has nothing to do with mobility, feeling awkward, has nothing to do with like, I don't know if I can move it. Imagine if you could just kind of just manipulate your body the way you want within reason, within good control. That's what we're talking about. When you train these types of movements, when you do things like Prime Pro or FRC, or you focus on mobility, it gives you that ability to just be able to jump into a movement and be able to move in an optimal way. Otherwise, you're going to be stuck in this whole like, where I'm in this situation now because I didn't do this for the 90% of my training career, where I have to fucking prime and do everything so much before I train. And that's just where I'm at now. But as I continue to do it, I notice it gets better and better. Like, I have to prime less today than I did last month. What I'm saying?
Because
I've been doing it now more consistently.
Right.
Next question is from Ander Beth. What is better for leaning out, CrossFit or Orange Theory?
if I had
to pick those?
If we consider that both sides have good coaches, because it's always going to go down to the coach, right? A shitty CrossFit coach is not going to be as effective as an excellent Orange Theory coach, and vice versa. So if both coaches are really, really good, then I have to say pretty clearly that CrossFit. And because CrossFit utilizes far more effective movements.
Well,
they weight train.
This is a
thanks, Justin.
This is another top of the shit pile or tallest midget situation, though. This is like not the
worst case scenario.
This is not the ideal situation that I would want. And if you looked at me and said, I want to get shredded, I want to lean out, oh, should I do CrossFit, should I do Orange Theory? Like, if that's like how you're already thinking, I would already say we're already heading down the wrong path. Like, I think there's so many other things that need to be addressed that don't even require you to do this circuit training.
Well, already it's the wrong mentality.
It is.
You're trying to lean out by using circuit training.
Yeah, it's exactly. It's not
it's
you
the
and
wrong
much,
method.
Unless you're in a good place. Like if you're a good play, if you're in a good place, you've got good myomechanics.
Now that's a very good point.
Same way we recommend HIIT. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
MAPS HIIT. Like no. We even say in there, like you need to have some experience. You need to know what you're doing. You're not, this is definitely not for a beginner to just lose weight.
Right. If we are taking a person, which by the way would probably fit in the 5 percentile, that has got great body mechanics, that has got their nutrition lined up, they've got 6 weeks to go, and they have either or Orange Theory or CrossFit. Which one's going to get me the most shredded? CrossFit will, and it's a very clear and cut because. Orange Theory completely eliminated all the Olympic lifts, which I think is smart because they know a majority of the people.
It's dangerous.
Do they even use barbells anymore?
No.
It's only dumbbells.
Yeah.
They don't even do squats and deadlifts.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Deadlifts and squats.
Yeah. So
that's,
it's not even close that CrossFit close. would trump it as far as because you can build way more muscle doing CrossFit than you ever will doing Orange Theory. Therefore, it's by far going to benefit you as far as the speed of getting leaned out. The problem with that theory is that the reason why Orange Theory is so successful is because they got rid of all those Olympic movements.
It requires less skill.
Because it doesn't require as much skill, and most people can't perform them correctly, and they're getting hurt and all these other reasons. So I think neither one of them are a great option. When I'm training someone to get ready for a show, including myself, the cardio is the last thing. So burning tons of calories manually is the last thing that I go to.
Yeah.
I am manipulating your programming and your nutrition to get you to shred as fast as possible without even touching, let's add a bunch more of exercise and movement, because I know that that's the least substantial thing. I know I could teach somebody to resist eating something or to make smarter workout choices than I can to add more movement and more time in their
day.
And
just looking at it, just look at it as a calorie burn.
Right.
That's what tends to happen.
Yes.
Like, I need to burn this many calories today. You know,
then you're not moving the whole rest of the day, you know, too. Like I get into a little bit of a debate with this because I prefer to just have people like super active. You know, if you want to go in that direction, like just having all day long, like you're active versus like super intense, like one window of like an hour.
When I teach a competitor, you know, again, I've helped Melissa out, even though I don't see her anymore like I used to when she's competing, but she's getting ready for another show. And now she'll just every once a week, she'll send me over like, hey, this is what I'm doing, coach, what's going on? And no cardio right now. It's all NEAT based. And she's 5 weeks out from a show getting lean and shredded right now. And the only thing I would say, I go, okay, take your steps now up to 18 to 20,000 a day. That's all I want you to do. Mm-hmm. Just move throughout the day walking, still not doing. And then when we do introduce cardio, it'll look like this. All right, for the next week, I want you three to five times after your workout, give me 12 to 15 minutes of just HIIT cardio. Mm-hmm. Just right afterwards, 12, 15 minutes. That's it. But that's, you're talking about like an elite athlete that's competing.
And she's like 5 weeks out from
a show. Right. And 5 weeks out from a show, you're the average person. None of that advice is even, all I'm focusing is NEAT. NEAT and lifting.
From a purely calorie burning perspective, okay, if you're living in that paradigm of, I need to burn this many calories, okay, forget anything else. Just from a purely how many calories I burn perspective, it doesn't fucking matter what you do. It really doesn't. Like if all you care about is I need to burn 600 calories right now, then it doesn't matter. So you might as well do some housework or some other shit that's going to benefit
dig.
You.
Yeah, in your backyard.
Yeah, that's going to benefit you. That versus running in place, doing burpees or taking a class. Now that being said, there are other things that matter while burning calories. Can I build muscle? Can I improve upon my mobility? Can I improve upon my strength? Can I speed up my metabolism through that process? And the answer is you potentially could, in which case you want to do that. You definitely want to do that. You don't want to just burn calories because you don't need a fucking class to do that. You could literally stand and run in place and count the calories that you burn, and boom, voila, you've accomplished your ridiculous objective, which isn't going to really help you that much.
Right.
Just burning calories is a lot of work and a little bit of return.
Mm-hmm.
It's you're trying to dig a ditch with a spoon.
Yeah.
Like, you can do it.
You spin your wheels.
Yeah, you can go dig a fucking pool with your spoon. go try it, but you're going to be there for months and it's going to be super inefficient.
This is such a hard conversation to have with a client too, especially when they come to you with a question like this, because I'm sure whoever this is, there's probably something in mind that she's got a Vegas trip in 4 or 6 weeks.
On the hustle right,
right
now.
Right, right. It's like now. It's like, holy shit, we planned this last year.
What do I do?
The girls and I are going to Vegas next month. It's pool parties. Here we come. And oh shit, I'm not in the shape that I thought I was going to be in this time of the year. It's like, okay, now I got to get after it. Now I'm going to ask Mind Pump, what is the fastest way for us to get me in shape there? It's like, well, fuck, man. Okay, Yeah, you could just start starving the body like crazy, training these high-intensity classes, and in the next 4 to 6 weeks, you probably will make the most change that you can in your physique by doing that. The problem is that as soon as you go party and have a good time and you come back, like, you're going to be up shit creek, you know, back to square one again.
Yeah, right? You're going to be stuck in that hamster wheel.
Oh, yeah. Each time you try and do that again, it's going to be even harder.
But really hard to tell someone that, because I'll tell someone that and they're like, I don't care.
Exactly.
I don't care.
All I care about is this one thing.
Yes, I don't care. Yeah. So tell me.
Bro, I get messages every year from family members. Every year.
Yeah.
To the point where I got so mad, I think it might have been even my brother, where he'll send, and this always happens, like, oh, dude, what's the best way to eat to lose like the most weight in 3 weeks?
Yeah.
And I'll be like, dude, listen, okay, I've written you programs.
Yeah.
I've written you meal plans. I've talked to you about nutrition. I've told you how the body works. This is the 15th time you've asked me this stupid question on how to lose. You want to know how you lose the most weight in 3 weeks? Here's what you do. Don't eat. You want to lose weight even faster? Cut your leg off. The scale will go down. Like, I get so mad with people that keep asking me the same fucking question. I'm like, you know what's going to happen next year? You're going to come back and ask me again, what's the fastest way? Can you give me some more time? How about you tell me, hey, Sal, what's the best way I can get in shape for next year? Then we'll sit down and talk. But you always got to come to me 3 weeks before your event.
Yeah, right.
And it's like, I don't know. Cut your carbs. Eat super low calories. Do a lot of cardio. There you go.
Well, I love the extreme analogy because it's really true. I mean, that's what you're doing. Like, if you're asking me, I've only got 4 to 6 weeks to work with you and I want to lose the most amount of body fat as possible. Well, quite frankly, don't eat for the next 6 weeks. I mean, that will do it. And it's like, and people, oh, that's crazy. I'm not going to do that. Well, you're asking me crazy.
That's the answer to your
answer to your stupid question. And if you think that's crazy, then be just a little less crazy. Maybe eat every 3 days from now until you know what I'm saying? Like, that's really where you're going with a question like that, where it's
ideal. A dumb mentality, so it deserves a dumb response.
It is. And so if I'm trying to help this person, and so first we try to help by explaining that, so hopefully you get the point, but you know, from this point to whatever it is that you have, because I'm sure this person has a date in mind, whether it be Vegas or a wedding or something that's coming up really soon, and that's why the question came out, each week you want to create more movement, and which will create a caloric deficit somehow, and you don't want to go extreme, because if you go really extreme right out the gates, then you're going to see diminishing returns over the second, third, fourth, and fifth week. So you want to do just enough of restriction calorie-wise, or create just enough extra movement that you have a nice little 500 to 1,000.
Get rid of all your furniture.
Yeah.
You know what I
mean? What? Yeah. Oh, so you don't sit down?
Just get rid of all your furniture, right?
Yeah.
That's actually sit down.
Yeah. You can't fucking relax.
And nutrition is going to play the biggest role.
Right.
Bottom line. So, you know, CrossFit, Orange Theory, you know, resistance training, running, aerobic, whatever. Your food intake is going to play the biggest role with this. But if you had to pick, if you're forced between the two and they both have really, really good coaches, CrossFit wins.
Yeah, and you have good mechanics for sure. Yep.
Next question is from Ray Lehman. How do you recommend measuring and tracking body composition? What do you think is an ideal healthy body fat percentage for a woman who does not intend to compete but wants to be fit?
So I get this question a lot, and that's why I picked it.
Yeah, what's a good body fat percentage?
Well, no, first
of all, testing-wise, anything better than the hydrostatic?
Well, let's address that first. So here's the thing with that, all of them. It turns into this thing where we, again, like camps. You know, what is like, this skin fold is this.
The bod pod.
Then it's like all these different ways to measure. Decks. And to be honest, even the worst one is within about a percent or two of accuracy. Even like your shittiest of scales. Maybe probably the worst thing out there is probably some
bioelectric impedance.
Probably some Walmart fucking stand on the scale thing that's fucking cheap, right? But if you've got skin fold, you've got bod pod, you've got the hydrostatic, all those are within like 0.2% of each other, right? Mm-hmm. So what I tell clients is whatever is most convenient for you. Whether you got a bod pod nearby, you can go get a hydrostatic wet. You can get skin fold done. Even if you have one of those bioimpedance ones that like at NutriShop or whatever, even those are fine. You're really using it as a tool, a feedback tool for you. It is not the fucking end. It is not the answer. It is not what should be like, oh, I'm here, so that means I'm doing this right. No, it's like, it's just like the scale to me. It's just like the what your scale says up or down. It is not the end all. It does not mean necessarily that good or bad is happening. It's just a because
starting point.
Yeah, it is. It's a starting point. It's a, and it gives you a little bit more feedback that, okay, I'm at this percent body fat. Doesn't matter what it reads. Doesn't even matter if it's that accurate. It's that, okay, I use this tool. I woke up at this time. You got to be consistent with it, whatever tool you use, right? Mm-hmm. I want to do it first thing in the morning. I don't want to eat. I don't want to drink anything. I want to do it right away, you know, and then from there, I'm going to apply my theory, which is if I do these exercises and I eat this way, I should hopefully lose body fat and or build muscle. And then I come back and I check in 2 to 4 weeks and I use that and what it says to tell me how close I am to being right. And at the end of the day, I'm never going to be 100% perfect, but I hopefully after those 2 to 4 weeks, I can look back and see that, hey, it looks like I've lost some body fat. It looks like I've built a little bit of muscle. And or if it's off a little bit, I didn't lose that much body fat and I didn't move in the right way. Now I have a tool that's giving me feedback that I can go, oh, okay, it looks like I was cutting too many calories. I was cutting so hard that I was equally losing fat and muscle that fast because I was restricting too much. So I'm going to bump my calories a little bit, right? So that's how I'm using the body fat percentage. Yeah.
It's not the accuracy of the body fat test isn't as important as the consistency of the body fat test. What I mean by that is body fat tests all vary in terms of their accuracy. So like, underwater weighing is the most accurate in terms of measuring the closest to what your actual body fat percentage is. So that's going to be the most accurate. But what you really want, what you should really care about is how consistent are the readings. And what I mean by that is, for example, bioelectric impedance, where you put your hands on the handles and it sends a electric, you know, wave or whatever through your body, and then that will calculate how much body fat you have. The problem with that one is it's not super consistent. Like I could test my body fat right now, then I could go hydrate the shit out of myself with water and carbs, test it again, and my body fat will have changed. So it's inconsistent. And so that's what you don't want. You don't want inconsistency. What you want is something that's going to give you the same reading, you know, now and it will, you know, 10 minutes from now, even if my body position is different or whatever.
Yeah, you have to standardize it.
That's it.
You have to have a process where I'm not eating and I'm doing it first thing in the morning. You know, I have it scheduled. It's the same exact routine ritual that you duplicate the next time you go to test.
Right.
Otherwise, all those variables will skew your results.
Right. So you want it to be consistent so that you can measure it on a weekly basis and see what the trend is. Because if it's an inconsistent method of body fat testing, well, then it's tough because if it's off by a percent, you don't know if you gained fat or lost fat.
It's the same way that I use my Fitbit right now. Mm-hmm. Like someone could say, oh, the Apple Watch is more accurate to the stride. It's 0.2% closer to the average.
Yeah, as long as it's consistent, nobody cares.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me which tool is 0.25% more accurate than the other one. Like that doesn't fucking matter to me. I'm using it as feedback for me. If I'm using the same tool all the time, it's consistent. That's unless, all I care
that's
about.
That's my point.
Unless you get fuel points, then you're like, what the fuck does that mean? Way to go, Nike.
Yeah, way to go. Nike dropped.
What the hell is fuel
that
points?
It just went away, too.
It just died.
It died completely.
It was super cool and just totally useless.
Yeah, all you want is the tool to be consistent. The tool's consistent. That's fine. And then you use that as the feedback.
Now, as far as like what body fat percentage you want to aim for, well, if you're a woman, you definitely don't want to be above 30% body fat.
Is it a competitor asking a question? What did it say?
Just a normal person. And if you're a man, you definitely don't want to be above 20% body fat. Now, why those numbers? Why 20 for a man and why 30 for a woman? Well, two things. First off, women naturally have a higher percentage of their body weight be body fat. So a man that's at 10% body fat, and for a woman to have the equivalent rate of leanness, she's probably going to be around 15% or 16% or something like that. So women are always going to measure higher. But why did I come up with 20 and 30%? There is some literature that suggests that when a man goes above 20% body fat, for example, that the negative health associations that come with body fat start to dramatically increase. So in other words, he could be fit, he could be very healthy, But the mere fact that his body fat now is above 20% and climbing, that will now start to give him negative health effects. And for a woman, that number is 30%. So because there is a – you can have a man who's 10% and you can have another man that's 17%. And both of them can be extremely healthy, even though one has a lot more body fat.
Right, right.
You know, they could have healthy diets. They could have good activity. You know, everything is good. So, you know, as far as that concerned, it doesn't make a huge difference. But when it comes to above 20% for a man, now you start to see negative health effects. And for a woman, above 30%, you start to see those negative health effects. Now, as far as what women are typically seeking, because the question is, where should I be?
Right.
Most women I've trained are happy in the low 20s. Most women are very happy at 20%, and most women are extremely happy in the high teens for body fat.
Yeah.
So I would say probably 18 to 23% is probably a range where
that's a really good
most of my clients have been like, this is where I like to be.
Most of my female personal trainers that work for me, you know, like a good fit personal trainer was 16 to 18% yeah. body fat for a female.
And
a fit personal trainer.
Exactly.
Yeah, a fit personal trainer is walking around 16, 18% for a female, and for a guy is probably walking around 10 to 12%, you know. So that's kind of what the, you know, if you're looking at a personal trainer as
And for a guy.
And I know there's obviously a bunch of trainers out there that look terrible, but that gives you, give you an example of, you know, what a fit personal trainer.
And then for a guy, it's probably like, I know for most men, a six pack appears right around 10%. So, you know, give or take a percent, depending on your how developed your abs are. I know my abs didn't show up until I got about 8%. But then when I started to build my abs, now they show at, you know, 10 or 11%.
Right.
So there's that range there. But for
And that's going to, you know, that's something too. Like when we get, another reason why I don't get caught up in the percentages is, man, you know, a lot of competitors that I compete with don't even pay attention to.
Why would you care? Nobody cares what your body fat percentage is when you're on
because
stage.
Because certain people hold
Nobody cares in real life either.
Yeah. Yeah. They
go with how you look.
No,
that's it.
I was one of the few bodybuilders that actually used like the dunk tank and things like that. And again, I was using it as a tool. Like I used it because,
feedback.
I was constantly manipulating things in my program, manipulating things in my diet and going like, okay, I think if I restrict this much, I should just carve off body fat if I do this correctly. And then I would get the tool, use the feedback and go like, oh, good. I was right on point. Or, oh, shit, that was too much. I cut too hard. I need to add more calories. Or I didn't cut hard enough, right? So I think learning to use it like that, not getting caught up in a percentage or a number, because I've seen many bodies at the same percentage look completely different.
Yeah.
And some people have fatty organs. Some people have their organs are a lot because their diet. This is like skinny fat people. Mm-hmm. You've seen this a lot, right?
Oh, yeah.
Where you have somebody who doesn't look like they're fat, but they test really, really high because their organs are really fat.
Yeah.
And it's much of the time.
Well, they've got that visceral body fat. You'll see this in men. You'll see this in women sometimes too, where sometimes you have a female client who's just obviously doesn't lead a good healthy lifestyle, maybe high cortisol, food intolerances, and she'll store body fat more like a man. You'll see more of this midsection body fat, and she'll get her legs will get skinny, everything else will get skinny in her midsection, in which case, you know, changing the lifestyle to make it more healthy and not simply just eating less calories and burning more calories.
Right.
But I would say for a guy, you know, 12 to 15% is probably, you know, where most men would be happy, the average guy. And for a woman, I'd say anywhere between 19 to like 23% or something like that is probably. And you know, some women like to be even in the mid 20s, especially if you're a woman that likes to be more voluptuous and curvy. Like you can be 25% body fat and
look hella good.
If you're healthy and you're fit and you have good, the way you store body fat represents that. Yeah, yeah. Go ahead. Goes to the right areas. Right?
Yeah, man.
Hey, look, a lot of people, believe it or not, don't realize that we all have our own independent social media pages.
Say why?
That's right. Each of us have different information on each of these pages. You can go on Justin's page or Adam's page or my page, see what we're up to, see what we're talking about, if we're posting any studies, any fitness stuff, funny stuff, whatever. You can find us all on Instagram. My page is Mind Pump Sal. Justin is Mind Pump Justin. And Adam is Mind Pump Adam.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.